Research Center for Women's Studies. I welcome the invited guests, well-wishers and friends of the center, heads of the department, faculty, colleagues and students to the 13th Dr.Neera Desai Memorial Lecture. The Research Center for Women's Studies instituted Dr.Neera Desai Memorial Lecture in the memory of Dr.Neera Desai, its founding director and pioneer of women's studies in India in 2010. In the course of this journey, we have received support from Dr.Neera Desai's friends, fellow travelers in social movements, colleagues and well-wishers of women's studies and women's movement. They have all collaborated in making this lecture series a grand success. And so have our guest speakers, from Professor Susi Tharu, the first guest speaker of the lecture series, to Professor Sujata Patel, who delivered the 12th memorial lecture. All the lectures have tried to carry forward Dr.Neera Desai's legacy and the philosophy of women's studies in India as articulated by Dr.Neera Desai, which emphasized on and around concepts of theory as practice, transdisciplinarity, feminist critiques of objectivity, and philosophies of power, knowledge, and plural perspectives in knowledge production. Continuing with the legacy, we are indeed fortunate to have Professor Kalpana Kannabiran deliver the 13th Dr.Neera Memorial, Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, and Advocate Mihir Desai preside over the lecture. I request Dr. Putul Sathe to welcome them. Thank you, madam. It is indeed a privilege to introduce the keynote speaker and chief guest of the 13th Dr.Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, Professor Kalpana Kannabiran. Professor Kalpana Kannabiran is a feminist sociologist and lawyer whose work has focused on the intersections of sociology, law, literature, gender studies, and social movements. A co-founder of Asmita Resource Center for Women, Secunderabad, set up in 1991 and active for 30 years till 2021, she was part of the founding faculty of NALSAR, University of Law, Hyderabad, where she taught from 1999 to 2009. For a decade, from March 2011 to March 2021, she was Regional Director, Council for Social Development, Hyderabad, a center for advanced research in social sciences established by Durgabai Deshmukh in the year 1960s and supported by ICSSR. She has published 26 books in the field of interdisciplinary law, gender studies, and disability studies by leading publishers and over 100 journal articles and book chapters. For 25 years, she has been a human rights columnist and contributed over 100 op-eds to leading national newspapers and news portals. She was General Secretary of the Indian Association of Women's Studies from 1998 to 2000, to date the youngest person to have held that position, and has been active in the International Sociological Association as Chair, Research Committee on Women in Society. She was the member of the program committee for two World Congresses of Sociology and was elected to the Executive Committee of the International Sociological Association from 2014 to 2018. She received the Rockefeller Humanist in the Residence Fellowship at the Human Studies Program, Hunter College, City University of New York in 1992-93. The VKRV Rao Prize for Social Science Research in 2003, and the Amartya Sen Award for Distinguished Social Scientist in 2012 for her work in the field of law. Most recently, she served a three-year term as Civil Society Advisory Governor, Asia Region, Commonwealth Foundation, London, completing her term in December 2022. I request Professor Kannabiran to deliver the 13th Dr.Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, ma'am.
Good afternoon, friends. And I will begin by thanking Dr. Putul Sathe for this invitation to speak, which is not an occasion that I encounter in the normal course. It is special and it will be unique for me for now and for the rest of my life. And I will tell you a bit about why. I am particularly gratified to have my good friend Mihir Desai with me here. Somebody I respect immensely for the work that he has done and who I value immensely for that work and for his connection to my to the couple that was dearest to my heart, Neera Desai and A.R. Desai. We have many good friends here with us today, and I hope that what I say, which is really quite scattered, not in the form or structure of a memorial lecture, will nevertheless make sense. But before I go to the theme of my lecture, I would like I said, I will never ever have this chance again. I would like to talk very briefly about my association with Neera Ben and what she has meant to me in my life. I'm returning to RCWS after a span of 38 years. I was here as a rookie research assistant, 25 years old, hired on my first job, bumbling my way through research that I did not know how to do. My first employer was Professor Neera Desai. She was the director of the center, and I just wandered into her room and said, I want a job. And she said, join as research assistant. And that was it. It was my first job. I was here. I wouldn't say she gave me freedom. She left me to do what I wanted to do. And, you know, allowed me to blunder my way along and find my way, always making sure that she was there. As I was thinking about her, and I've been thinking a lot about her, especially this past month, much more than I normally do, I just realized that what she also demonstrated to me early on, as soon as I set foot into the world, was how one could be a director. It wasn't something that I consciously observed, that I consciously noted. But, you know, as I kept thinking about her in that room and me in the other room, and how often I used to just open the door and go in and, Neera Ben, can you tell me this? Or Neera Ben, can you tell me that? I realized that 30 years later, when I became the director of an institute, I was actually modeling myself on her. I'm not sure that I succeeded. I'm not sure how much I succeeded. But it was like, you know, those were the first lessons that, you know, the director doesn't need a peshi. The director must have an open door. The director must be completely nonpartisan. The director must not be a controlling person, but must always make sure that everybody understands that when you turn around, you know the director has your back. Yeah, and those have really stayed with me. My contact while I was here for 6 months wasn't, you know, wasn't intense, but it was extremely affectionate. And like I said, I knew that she had my back. I met her, of course, the previous year. I worked here between 85 and 86. I met her in 1984. I met both of them, Professor A.R. Desai and Neera Ben, for the first time in 1984, when they were invited by my father's friend, who V.V. Garu also knew very well, Mr. M.V. Ramamurthy, the radical humanist, who used to organize the most unusual meetings in Hyderabad. And he organized a meeting which he called Marriage Yesterday, Today, Tomorrow. Okay. And A.R. and Neera Ben were the speakers, his star speakers. And then he walked into my house And I was at that time 24 or so. And he said, from Hyderabad, you will be our local speaker. And, you know, I was always an outlier in these civil liberties circles. I was around, but watching, never part of it, totally never an insider. And I said, but why me? And he said, no, we need to hear from the younger generation. You get onto that stage and you speak. This was, it also happened to be about 3 months or so before I myself got married. And I got married early as a conscious decision. And so I got up on that stage and Professor A.R. Desai said there shouldn't be arranged marriages. Marriages should be for love. And, you know, he made a really radical speech. And I said, wow. And then I got up and said, but why marriage at all? You know, I mean, okay, marriage for love, but why marriage at all? Not necessary. Yeah, because as an institution, it's kind of oppressive. And yeah, I don't think many people in the audience approved of it, but A.R. and Neera Ben did, you know. And 3 months later, he came to Hyderabad University, where I was doing my MPhil. I had finished my dissertation. He came as my MPhil examiner. And, gave me his personally typed copy of my MPhil report and had a long discussion off the record with me about my MPhil in the Viva. He said, you just answer the questions formally. And so, you know, I mean, it was just you can imagine, it is like a 24, 25 year old and you are meeting the big dada of sociology. You know, it was not the other people, it was A.R. Desai who mattered to me, yeah? And he's coming and he's saying, you know, this is the right track, this is what you need to follow. And then I come here and I work with Neera Ben, and then I get the UGC fellowship, and A.R. says, the first thing, he says, I said, I want to talk to you. He's, what are the three theaters? Meher, Badal, Bijli, Barkha. He said, come to Dadar, Badal, Bijli, Barkha, you turn there, you'll come to my apartment, come and meet me. So I went and met him. And he said, please don't register here. Manorama Savur is the only person who should guide you and she's retiring. Go to Delhi, I will speak to Yogendra Singh. He will treat you well. His thing was not, he knows the subject, he will be. He said, all of that is there. But for PhD, what is important is a supervisor who treats you well. I will speak to Yogendra Singh, you go and... So I just, you know, blindly, I did not evaluate universities. The minute I'd had that conversation, and Neera Ben sat in on that conversation, I just did not even evaluate another university. I went straight to JNU, straight to Yogendra Singh, and registered for a direct PhD. And when I went in for my Viva, who should be my external examiner but Neera Ben? You know? So it was just like serendipity, repeating over and over and over again. And then, of course, I got elected onto the IAWS, and it was a most traumatic experience because, the big four mothers in IAWS are extremely ageist, extremely, and in a very negative kind of way. So being a 37-year-old who suddenly found herself in the position of a general secretary was something that they just could not stomach. And there again, Neera Ben had my back. So every time they literally, and I'm not joking, they drove me to tears. And every time they drove me to tears, I would just turn back and say, Neera Ben, what do I do? She said, you just keep going. You're on the right track. You know, so it's like, I can't actually put in words what she meant to me and what delivering this lecture, you know, kind of means to me. So, yeah, Neera Ben, this is for you, wherever you are. The work that I will speak of today is work that I commenced in 1988. This was work that she was my external examiner for, and concluded in 1992, in one sense, but the concerns have extended well into the present. I began earlier, in 1986, as part of my interest in examining the ways in which caste is articulated through and in gender in agrarian society. The field site I chose was a village close to Virudhunagar in southern Tamil Nadu, in which the Telugu-speaking Vaishnavite Vadugans, as the Kamavar Nayakars were called, those from the north, Vadugans are those from the north, were the dominant landowning caste. While I could not stay with it and write my thesis on what I observed in this society, it's one of those many, many failed PhD projects that fall by the wayside, never forgotten, never adequately remembered. What it did lead to was a series of accidents that led to my discovery of land records, that is, Inam settlement registers, pertaining to quote-unquote Devadasis. So every time I use Devadasis in this talk, it will be within quotes. In the revenue department of Ramnad district in the early 20th century, these land records represent for me the crux of what I refer throughout this talk today as Devadasi reform, a trope that refracted the questions of normativity, sexuality, conjugality, and morality through the frame of law embedded in questions of land. The materiality was central to the construction of Devadasi reform in more ways than one. At the time that I explored this question, there were only a few other works on this problem in colonial India. In terms of regional articulation, I focused on the Madras Presidency, which included the Tamil and the Telugu speaking areas, and found a multiplicity of practices of state, community, and society that defied a universal explanation. And this is one of the aspects that I will attempt to reflect on today. Alongside this, around 1991, I also co-authored the first focused theorizing of caste in contemporary scholarship, of caste and gender, which drew in no small measure from my insights from the field, that is my failed project, and on the archives, which was my subsequent refuge. So I escaped from the field into the archives, and that's one trajectory that's possible. There has since 93 been a burgeoning of scholarship that has opened out different dimensions of Devadasi life worlds in performance and in socialities. There has also been a recovery and rehabilitation of proscribed performative traditions that has been deeply contentious in terms of the moves, the dual and the triple moves of assimilation, stigmatization, integration, appropriation of Devadasi practices. Gradations of caste are central to this debate, with Devadasis located at different rungs in the caste complex. Devadasi reform offered new avenues of citizenship for reformed Devadasis in the early periods of nationalism. The legal interventions that actually resulted from such deliberations, however, severely curtailed Devadasi women's prospects for the future. This was true of both the reformed and the unintegrated Devadasis. I use the term unintegrated, borrowing from Davesh Soniji's work. There were poignant stories of loss and disenfranchisement in the wake of social reform movements throughout the 20th century. We have ethnographic accounts of women who were so disenfranchised, insisting that aesthetics were central to understanding the past and the present from within the communities. We also have these women who were dispossessed, insisting that they were denied the right to worship by being banned from entering the temple. I will use stories and tales that illuminate this discussion and this dispossession. I will first recall Saride Manikyamma, who we met in her village home in 2000. Born in 1910 in a village called Balipadu in West Godavari district, Manikyamma was a Devadasi dedicated to the worship of Madanagopala Swami in a 17th century temple in the village. Her mother was a temple Devadasi earlier, but gave up her profession for a family life. Manikyamma was trained in the art of dancing by Mahalakshmamma, a Devadasi from a neighboring village. Dancing being her life from the age of 5, Manikyamma performed the Rangapuja at 9 and was ready to take on the traditional rituals of the temple. She danced in worship of Madanagopalaswamy for 40 years in a style that exquisitely blended the essence of Bharatavarnam and Abhinaya Darpanam. At dawn and dusk, her feet sparkled out in Allaripu, Kautam, Sabdam, Varnam, Padam, Javali. She sang as she danced. She had a great fondness for the kirtanas of the Adhyatmika Ramayanam. She choreographed 104 songs and performed them, bringing the Ramayanam vividly alive in her performance. Into this spiritual life in which music and dance provided the living breath, the state rudely entered with its Endowments Act. Abolishing temple properties meant 20 acres of land that Manikyamma had enjoyed, please note, not owned, but enjoyed as her traditional inheritance, became government property. With the abolition of temple dancing, Manikyamma was deprived of vocation and avocation, suddenly surrounded by poverty and despair. Not knowing who she could dance or sing to, Manikyamma took refuge in a village called Duva and settled selling off her belongings one by one. After many years in this condition, she went to a conference on Abhinaya in Rajamundry in 1972. Seeing Manikyamma perform Abhinaya and hearing her sing, dance guru Nataraj Ramakrishna brought Manikyamma to Hyderabad in 1974 to take classes in Abhinaya at the Sangeet Natak Academy, and she taught pupils the Adhyatmika Ramayanam. Then she moved to become guest faculty in the Sarojini Naidu School of Performing Arts in University of Hyderabad in 1990, teaching students to perform the same. She was in Hyderabad till 1995, teaching dance. Her question to us when we met her in 2000 was poignant. The Lord was used to waking up to my performance. How would he wake up if I did not perform? This when one morning she was told it was now illegal for her to enter the temple precincts. In 95, with both Nataraj Ramakrishna and Manikyamma aging and suffering from chronic ill health, Ramakrishna called her nephews who came to Hyderabad and took her to their village on the pretext of a family wedding. Once there, she was told she could not go back to Hyderabad. Life and purpose were snatched away a second time from her, because she told us that she would have been happier if she had just died one day of old age in Hyderabad, because she had been living there and teaching there. I'm interested in excavating and opening out the frames of law in Devadasi reform then, in stories like Manikyamma's and stories unlike hers. In doing that, I look at law in literature around Devadasi reform in relation to a graded Devadasi system, graded to sync with the graded caste order. And you will hear echoes of Baba Saheb Ambedkar in this. So, basically, I then focus on two works of fiction and two autobiographies. This was not part of my doctoral work. It's work that I looked at in cursory fashion subsequently. In trying to understand the ways in which the law may be constructed and propagated in literature, the two works of fiction that I look at are one in, written in Tamil in 1930s, Dasigal Mosavalai, which I then co-translated as Web of Deceit, by a woman from an Isai Velalar community or caste who was a proponent of abolition, Muvalur Ramamirthammal. The Isai Velalar caste is a touchable caste. It is not a quote-unquote untouchable or Dalit caste. Yeah, a number of members of this caste today identify themselves as Bahujan, but they are within the touchable caste order. The author Moovallur Ramamirthammal was a follower of Muthulakshmi Reddy, and she was a reformed Devadasi. The second novel I look at is a relatively recent novel by dancer scholar Srividya Natarajan, Undoing Dance, The Undoing Dance, that unpacks the layered complexity of law in its many avatars in the matter of Devadasi abolition, both these novels. So very briefly, Dasigal Mosavalai is about these two Dasis, I will call them Dasis because that is what they're called in the novel, about these two Dasis and their mother who are out to deceive and cheat rich patrons and minors, you know, as the rich men who had money and no vocation were referred to. And through a series of sleights of hand, towards the end of the novel, these two women find themselves completely dispossessed of property, money, jewelry, wealth, the permission to perform, because Devadasi abolition has come by then. So the novel is just, it takes you round from one patron to another, from one reformed Devadasi to the wife of a zamindar who's visiting them. And what you actually witness is a web of deceit that these two Dasis are locked in. But the web of deceit, the Dasigal Mosavalai, is actually the web of deceit of the Dasis, not the web of deceit that Dasis are locked in. So the title and the way the story is structured completely inverts the deceit, where in fact the victims of deceit are the Devadasis themselves, who are totally dispossessed and in many ways also subjected to extreme forms of disrespect, public humiliation. Yeah, I talk a little later about Sundar Bhupalan's work on rituals of humiliation. So what you witness is that, but that isn't the popular reading of Dasigal Mosavalai. Srividya Natarajan, unlike Moovallur Ramamirthammal, is a Brahmin woman who trained with renowned Nattuvanar Vadyar Kittapapillai, who was from the Isai Velalar caste. And you have a number of Brahmin dancers who have trained with the last generation of Isai Velalar teachers. Srividya, of course, has struck a very different route. The novels speak of different but overlapping periods and reflect different political positionalities. Common to both these tellings is the experience of dispossession by law of a diverse community of performers of touchable castes who were systematically denuded of their intellectual and moral property, art and land and wealth, through the many shades of legislations and judicial interpretations, leading finally to the Devadasi abolition acts in different regions at different points of time, starting with 1947, right up to about early 1980s. Although I look primarily at the Telugu and Tamil areas, we could draw parallels with Bombay, Goa, Savantwadi, which had its own act, Mysore, Karnataka. Both these tales in these novels begin with ascendant women performers of the Isai Velalar caste, with patronage from the feudal elite and even the colonial state, till the virtues of monogamous conjugality are entrenched through legislation as normative. So marriage, monogamous marriage, is now the only way to be, leading to destitution by robbery and cheating in Dasigal, and the uneasy integration into a Brahmin family in the Undoing Dance. In both cases, there is an erasure of artistry and performative lives, and the silent tolerance of violence by deceit, by even custodial rape. Oddly enough, in the web of deceit, the ones who suffer the deceit are Kanta and Ganavati, the main protagonists, Dasis. In the Undoing Dance, very briefly, Kalyani is conceived in a single moment of rape by a police officer of a Devadasi performer who had repudiated his advances. She is conceived in that moment of rape and trains as a dancer under her mother's supervision and under the supervision of a male Natuvanar with whom she has a relationship and a child. But then she gives up the child to her mother because her mother wants a better life for her and goes into Madras because by then the Devadasi performance has been appropriated into the music sabhas in Madras. It has become a Brahminical space of the music sabhas. And all of us know the December festival in Madras. So that is the beginning of the December festival. So she goes off to Madras, and one thing leading to another, she ends up marrying a Brahmin widower with a child from his dead Brahmin wife. Now what she discovers, she hides the fact of her own child and her earlier relationship. What she discovers later is that the Brahmin widower had in fact got himself vasectomized 1 week before her marriage so that there is no danger of his having a child of mixed caste. Okay? So she raises this Brahmin daughter, Brahmin stepdaughter as her own, but teaches her the nuances of Isai Velala traditions. In the process, making the Brahmin stepdaughter sensitive and alive to Isai Velala traditions. Srividya, in a personal communication to me, said that when she was constructing the daughter's figure, she often thought about herself and where she would locate herself in that whole thing. But the other thing that struck me as very, very telling is that Kalyani herself, for me, seems to be a thinly veiled portrait of M.S. Subbulakshmi. I remember my father telling me the story of the Madras male murder case, which was when he was in his youth and when MS was in her youth. The Madras male murder case, which nobody, I googled it, you can't find it. The novels, of course, neither of the two novels resolve anything for you. They leave you with a lot of questions. Why was the kind patron of Kalyani's mother unable to carry on a relationship with her? He decides to join the nationalist movement, and so he comes and pays one last loving visit and leaves. In the many, many years, he's been her single partner. In the many, many years that they were together, he also has a wife in Chennai, but that was an okay thing. But in the many, many years that they were together, she never once conceived. But when this police officer, who happened to be his brother, lusted after her and caught her when she was performing in a temple procession, slapped the act on her and raped her, in a single act of rape, she conceives. And there's a question that she asks, you know, why? I would have gladly raised a child, or I would have gladly been childless with my patron for the rest of my life. You know, but why was this the trade-off that I had to go through? With Moovallur Ramamirthammal and the Web of Deceit, of course, I've already talked about how the deceit was actually a deceit of the Devadasis, not a deceit by the Devadasis. And this, both these stories are about the identical caste location, the Isai Velalars. The parallel community in the Telugu areas are the Kalavantas, or the Kalavantulu in the Telugu areas, who are a touchable caste that had performers, male and female. The next two texts that I look at are both autobiographies. One, again, by a woman of Isai Velalar caste, Muthulakshmi Reddy, a doctor, very well known, who wrote, who belonged to the Tamil areas, and she was based in Madras. And she wrote two autobiographies, My Experience as a Legislator. She was a legislator in Madras. And the second was called Autobiography. And she was a major proponent of Devadasi abolition, introducing the bill in the Legislative Council. There was no doubt in Muthulakshmi Reddy's mind that the Devadasi system was equivalent to prostitution, was equivalent to commercial vice, and was equivalent to increased morbidity in the population, and therefore needed to be abolished. So she garnered arguments of medical, of health, public health, commercial vice, immorality, and talked about the need for monogamous conjugality. But of course, Muthulakshmi was located within mainstream Hinduism and propagated Devadasi abolition by saying that the Devadasi system was a corruption of hoary Hindu traditions. So, and that the Devadasis in earlier times were like the Vestal virgins of Greece. We don't know how chaste or unchaste Vestal virgins of Greece were, but they say. And so she basically saw the Devadasi tradition as a corruption. Yeah. The other person on this side, several decades after Muthulakshmi published her autobiographies, was Hemalata Lavanam in the Andhra areas, who also saw abolition of the Devadasi system as just. But Hemalata Lavanam was Dalit, and she was the daughter of an iconic Telugu poet, Gurram Joshua, who wrote Gabbilam. And a little bit more about their backgrounds would help. Both these reformers belonged to totally different political persuasions. Muthulakshmi was a staunch nationalist and Congress supporter, daughter of a Brahmin father and an Isai Velalar mother. While she spoke of prostitution and had an abolitionist approach to prostitution, and Devadasi system was synonymous, as I said, she saw it as a corruption. And Movalur Ramamirthammal, although she was a self-respecter, was a follower of Muthulakshmi Reddy. So they were crisscrossing. I mean, if you know the politics of the Tamil country, you know that Congress nationalism and the self-respect non-Brahminism are diametrically opposed in terms of a political ideology. But it was possible, and it did happen, that women managed interesting crossovers while focused on a particular issue. Hemalata Lavanam, on the other hand, was Dalit and Christian and college educated. She was daughter of the legendary Telugu poet Gurram Joshua, 1895 to 1971, whose iconic literary masterpiece Gabbilam is a treatise on justice that tells the story and sufferings of Dalits using a bat as a messenger of God, as a messenger to God. In this epic poem, he speaks of discrimination based on caste and faith, and of obscurantism and social injustice that prey on the most vulnerable people in society. And of course, I'm giving you a very, very crude, prosaic rendition of Joshua. This is not any part of his poetic richness, yeah? Not just that, Hemalata was married with her consent and choice to Lavanam, the son of Gora, another iconic Telugu writer of that time, who was a rationalist and founder of the Nastika Kendram, or the Atheist Society in Andhra Pradesh. And Hemalata, throughout her life, carried forward both the intellectual traditions. She set up the Joshua Foundation, and she carried forward the work of the Nastika Kendram, but focused on the reform of the criminal tribes. That was one major effort that she was involved in. And the second was Devadasi abolition. And when she addressed Devadasi abolition, she was only talking about the system of dedicating Dalit women as Devadasis in predominantly rural areas. And it was the system that Hemalatha Lavanam was, of course, talking about in her Telugu autobiography, Idi Na Jeevitam, is part of a complex of untouchability practices, which she then weaves in with her work in the Nastika Kendram, talking about the need to eliminate superstition, obscurantism, oppressions, social oppressions, through using reformatory legislation. She saw reformatory law as providing a better life or a better possibility for, and they were all, in a sense, they were single-minded in their purpose. They wanted the system abolished. They were addressing very different pieces of that system. Yeah? So today, in fact, even as we speak, there is a very contentious debate on whether Devadasi practice should be abolished, should it not, should there be an affirmation of the aesthetics and arts that are the repository of this community or not. And the largest number of Dalit groups singularly oppose Devadasi abolition, oppose the Devadasi system, and have a non-negotiable demand for abolition. Now, I think that what we are missing out in that debate is the fact that the Devadasi system was graded in the same way as the caste order is graded. And so these are two irreconcilable positions. There is, within the touchable castes that had performative traditions and intellectual property, that was then appropriated completely by Brahmin performers through Kalakshetra, but also otherwise. There was an appropriation, there was a dispossession of extremely knowledgeable performative traditions, and there are a whole section of women from those communities who are today asserting their right to be recognized as people belonging to Isai Velala traditions. Yeah? Because what happens is, like Kalyani's mother is raped by the police officer for performing in front of the temple, Isai Velalar women were refused entry into temples to perform. The art then moved to the Madras Sabhas. Two or three decades later, the Madras Sabhas then have performances of Brahmin women and upper caste women dressing up as Devadasis and doing Devadasi dance and going and performing in temples. So you have museumized the figure of the Devadasi while dispossessing the Devadasi, who is the repository of this tradition. So there is a dispossession there. But it's not, when you speak about the Jogin system, for instance, you are not speaking about the same practice. Yeah, and that is a very crucial and critical difference that gets lost in the larger debate on law reform for Devadasi abolition. From both the Isai Velalar or similar Kalavanta traditions and from the Jogin tradition, you have women denied of livelihood who might choose to move towards sex work. Not all of them did. Some of them chose marriage, some of them chose sex work, some of them chose other work. But you do have a significant number that chose sex work across the caste order. Yeah. So when we talk about legalizing sex work, or you talk about saying all Devadasi women are then pushed into sex work, it's not totally true for two reasons. One, it's not all Devadasi women who are pushed into sex work. There's some who also choose to remain single in open relationships. But it's also not true because by saying all Devadasi women, you are erasing the heterogeneity within that order that gives rise to very different experiences of oppression. You know, the oppressions of Isaivelalar women is not the oppression of Jogin Devadasi women. It is this very different. Muthulakshmi Reddy and Hemalata Lavanam were talking about totally different sets of people. There are also a host of other texts that would provide valuable insights, but I've confined myself to these for the present, more as an exploration of the intermeshing of law, caste, and futures of persons, bodies, societies, communities, with reference to Devadasi reform. And I reopened this archive at this time because of a resurgence of a debate where I feel that critical differences have been lost sight of. I move now to the the contextualization. I provided some context to Muthulakshmi Reddy's autobiography by discussing the two novels. To move to contextualizing of Hemalata Lavanam's memoir, it leads you in a totally different path. There were countless stories of dispossessions that had to do with livelihoods not related to artistic performance. The abolition of Inam settlements that I began my talk with were for all categories of temple service, not only for dancing and singing, for all categories of temple service by women, which included what was in Tamil called the Valakara Marakari Inam. The Valakara Marakari Inam is the sweeper's Inam, the woman who sweeps or the person who sweeps the temple premises, or not just the temple premises, but the temple properties. Yeah? Late 19th century accounts speak of Devadasis from, and I quote unquote, untouchable Madiga castes. This is the term that's used in the colonial record. They also speak of the excommunication of Devadasis from touchable castes for performing in the houses of Komtis and lower castes. So women who were so excommunicated came before colonial courts saying they have been excommunicated, and so they lose their community privileges. So challenging excommunication. But why? Because they performed in Komti's houses or in houses of castes located below the Isaivelalar. So the practice consisted of temple performance, temple labor, saloon performances in the houses of landlords and other feudal elite from the earliest time. And the cultural labor of performance existed alongside the manual labor of cleaning. We have no indication in these colonial accounts of whether there was a caste difference between these two categories. They just say that they came to court, but they don't tell us whether these women, that there are untouchable Madiga Devadasis, then there are Devadasis who come because they are excommunicated, but they don't tell us whether all these accounts are of the same caste, or of different castes, or of which castes. Yeah. The enslavement of women of Dalit castes by the feudal and neo-feudal caste lords, as one sees in the Jogin system in the Telugu states, where the practice of dedication was part of the untouchability complex, is something that is quite clear. On that, there is no ambiguity, that it was part of a larger system of caste enslavement. Sundar Bhupalan, in his 2017 analysis of the caste-race complex, suggests looking at caste through the lens of wrongs, making four claims: their ritualistic character, their occurrence as aggravated episodes of everyday violence of normal times, their reproduction of violent identities, and the corporeality of wrongs, that is, that wrongs have a physical implication on bodies of people, at the level of the individual body and the socialities that assemble individual selves for the perpetration of wrongs. A close reading of the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989 demonstrates the deeply gendered character of dominant caste wrongs, if we are to take Sundar Bhopalan's framework. Women's sexualized bodies are embedded in the Brahminical caste order in specific ways for Dalit women and for Savarna women. I use Savarna here in an expanded sense of touchable, although these communities or some members of these communities might politically identify themselves as Bahujan, as distinct from Dalit. The latter are slaughtered on a scale of transient, periodic, or contingent untouchabilities, yeah, during menstruation, new mother, widowhood, and so on. This is distinct from the untouchable, sexually violable body of the Dalit woman that you encounter through the Jogin system. And Hemalata Lavanam talks a great deal about that. This difference is rendered cognizable through an intersectional lens of caste gender and is fundamental to the caste order. The elaboration of the heteronormative Hindu social order also fits, and I use another legal category, also fits eunuchs. This is the legal term that is used. Also fits eunuchs on the scale of touchable, untouchable, or stigmatized bodies. And I say it is a legal term because in my state we have a law called the Andhra Pradesh Telangana Areas Eunuchs Act of 1919. Yeah, so the transgender persons in law have historically been referred to as eunuchs. Riveting gender plurality to the elaboration of intersectionality. And trans bodies and trans performative identities and repertoires are part of cultural practice, both in Savarna and in Dalit contexts. We see it with the Jogins, we see it with the Isai Velalars as well. Dancing, male dancers dancing to female characters, female dancers donning a male role. Gender plurality is quite central to performance. The most cogent articulation, of course, of the Dalit predicament with reference to the Devadasi system comes in what Sundar Bhopalan has called rituals of humiliation. If you look at the Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989, its 2015 amendment, section 3, subclause 1K says, whoever not being a member of a scheduled caste or a scheduled tribe performs or promotes dedicating a scheduled caste or a scheduled tribe woman to a deity, idol, object of worship, temple, or other religious institution as a Devadasi or any other similar practice or performs the aforementioned acts shall be guilty of perpetrating atrocity. So the definition of atrocity, while being expanded from 15 to 23 offenses in response to demands from Dalit communities across the world, across the country, but in this amendment, what I see particularly interesting is that this clause is in fact for me the culmination of the work of Hemalata Lavanam on this question. Although she also, like Muthulakshmi Reddy before her, spearheaded a Devadasi Abolition Act in the early 1980s, the more illuminating genealogy may be traced between the 2015 amendment and Lavanam's campaign through anti-caste imaginations of Joshua and the rationalist, rationalist repudiation of superstition and obscurantist religion that gets embedded then, entrenched then in this amendment. Yeah, Muthulakshmi Reddy also speaks of superstition, but she also speaks of superstition as a corruption of Hinduism, not as a repudiation of Hinduism. And these are two very different kind of positions that we take. And through all of these writings, we may have differences with every one of them, we may have differences with one or more of them. But if you take a recursive view of the literary representations of non-conjugal sexuality and relative female autonomy, people say that women in the Devadasi system enjoyed relative female autonomy and were not trapped in monogamous conjugality, both the abolitionist and the pluralist positions speak to an idea of politics and the publics in very specific, kind of almost insurgent ways. And there is, especially on the gender question, despite a patriarchal echo, there is a statement of feminist purpose, which then allows self-respecter Ramamritamal to cross over to nationalist Muthulakshmi Reddy in demanding the same law, a Devadasi abolition legislation. So the field that we are looking at is polyglot, many languages, many cultures, many practices, but the gradations of caste are inviolable. In that, there is no crossover between one rung and another rung. Those separations remain totally intact, so that the same legislation cannot actually handle all of it. And my argument, in fact, on why the 1947 Devadasi Abolition Act did not have any impact on systems of dedication in Dalit communities was that at that time, right up to the mid-1950s, reform legislation targeted upper caste women, targeted Savarna women. You wanted to create good Savarna subjects. You were not particularly interested in creating a good Dalit subject in the mainstream at that time. Now, once the reform agenda seems to have been achieved over a period of 3 or 4 decades, you say, okay, but now what do we do with Dalit women? But of course, the Dalit imagination was alive much before that. At the time of 1947, Gurram Joshua had already written, but that did not come into a mainstream articulation of how you need to create a citizen, an anti-caste citizen, if you like, with whom you could draw parallels across caste, because caste itself was a very inviolable kind of, inviolable gradations in a sense. And with this I come to my conclusion, which is that we see through this writing claims to a new plural, dialogic, non-hegemonic and egalitarian public contestations and debate and dialogue and dissent is key to that space, which is again relevant to us today. At one end, we have Muddupallani, the celebrated medieval courtesan, who swings into view through her condemnation by Vireshalingam Pantulu in the early 20th century for immorality, triggering her resurrection 3 centuries after her time by noted musician, dancer from the Devadasi tradition, Bangalore Nagaratnamma. At the other end, today, in 2017, we have the work of Hemalata Lavanam from the 1970s or so, and historian, contemporary historian, Chinnaya Jangam, who dedicates his seminal book, published I think in 2017, Dalits and the Making of Modern India, to his mother, Devudu Chinnubai, a single mother and jogini, who made sure her children escaped the inhumanity she lived through by getting an education and conquering a claim to justice on equal terms. There are complex echoes in this contestation, in debates on the spiritual, moral, existential, and literary, that signify the place of the Devadasi, that is courtesan, jogini, prostitute, sex worker, dancer, musician, of the wife, the mother, or the woman in a heterosexist, Brahminical, patriarchal caste order. Because at the end of it all, that is what we are stuck with till today. Languages of command and of affection, of oppression, of resistance and of ethical anger, of negation of unjust tongues and of dissemination, the language and tongues of songs and ballads, of epics, counter-epics, the languages of millennial awakening, and of course, speech of life worlds as lived. This was my life. Idi na jeevitam. Yeah? Through words and feelings embedded therein, imaginings of justice and love for humanity, these show us the power of the written word and the performative in all its hues. This knitting together of worlds of labor, including cultural labor, economic and social oppressions, hunger, deprivation, in an account of a casteless utopia, in Abrahmani traditions, in women's accounts as lived, underscore important aspects of this everyday resistance. This is relevant to our understanding of the rights and wrongs of Devadasi reform. Cutting right through it all is the importance of the collective memory, complex as it might be, of complex autochthonous traditions of radicalism in politics as a wayfinder for our shared entangled present and our futures. No one size fits all. And we must be attentive to and recognize realities of unintegratability and acknowledge the different meanings of the refusal to fall in line. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. We'll be taking questions after Advocate Meera Desai's talk. It is my pleasure and honor to introduce Advocate Meera Desai, who has agreed to preside over today's memorial lecture. Advocate Meera Desai is a human rights lawyer practicing as senior counsel in the High Court of Bombay and Supreme Court of India. He is the co-founder of Indian People's Tribunal and Human Rights Law Network. He was the former director of the India Center for Human Rights and Law and was co-founder of the magazine Combat Law. In 2003, he assisted the Asian Human Rights Commission in their fight on behalf of the tribal population to remain on land claimed by the Maharashtra State Farming Corporation. In 2005-06, he was co-convener of the IPT team that investigated communal violence in Orissa. He has a deep connection, as you all know, with the center and has been a friend and well-wisher of the center and the university. Sir, it is indeed an honor to have you preside over today's function. I request you to please deliver your presidential address.
Thanks. This is not going to be a presidential address of any kind. I am going to be very, very brief. I am not an expert on the subject which Kalpana spoke about, nor am I an expert on women's studies or feminist movement, though I would like to believe, possibly it's a delusion of mine, that I've imbibed some feminist values being in a family and being around people who have been feminists. Let me at the outset thank Dr. Sathe for having invited me here. Kalpana and I go back a long way, so we make demands on each other. We don't thank each other. We don't make requests. But let me at the same time say that I'm extremely happy that you managed to come here. Just a few thoughts. When Kalpana was talking about the kind of issues, even when as an outsider one thinks abolition is the answer, you know, it's such an oppressive system, it should be abolished, Devadasi system. We faced a similar problem here in Bombay, for instance, that when the bar dancing was abolished, I was representing a section of the bar dancers. Meena is very aware of that. I was representing a section of the bar dancers when we were opposing the abolition. We were saying that you can't close down the bars. And on the other side, there were a lot of Dalit groups who said that, look, bar dancing per se is an oppression of Dalits, and why would you say that they should not be abolished? I don't have an answer to it till now. But the kind of complex situations which get created in many of these issues is something which came through very, very clearly in Kalpana's address. And I think that's one thing which is, the other thing which came across is the whole intersectionality, caste, class, gender, which is the reason why you have women's studies centers, to look at the intersectionality. I was just, of course, what happened was that I was just sometime in the past, I mean, in fact, by the way, Kalpana, the first thing about Devadasi I read was an article by you in EPW in 1995.
Yeah.
So that was some long time back. Anyway, coming back to this, what is amazing is that in 1974 this center started and it is continuing till now. If you look at world over, the first center in the world started, Women's Studies Center, only in 1970. That is in San Diego, in Cornell, in USA. In fact, USA was even at certain level quite. I mean, you have an SNDT tradition which goes back to more than 100 years. But USA, for instance, many universities did not even admit women for undergraduate classes. And I was reading somewhere that in Yale University, for instance, which is one of the most prominent universities, in 68, first time women were admitted in undergraduate classes, 1968. And when one of the women who was in the history class, who was admitted to the history subject, she asked the professor that why don't you talk about history of women? So he said, he's supposed to have replied that it's like saying that we want to know about history of dogs. Okay, that was in 1968. Okay, and the reason why I'm talking about this is that from whatever I've read, whatever I've understood, that there is a massive funding cut on women's study centers across the country. And that's obviously directed towards not looking at women in a holistic way, but only looking at them in a traditional way, for which you don't need studies, because I think we've been told about it 2,000 years back as to what they are supposed to be doing. So why do you study them? You know. So it's important that that. And I feel proud that my mother was associated with this since 1974. Again, like ghar ki murgi dal barabar types, so that when she was, at least in the earlier period, I didn't realize what was the work she was doing, but so later on that, you know, one tended to realize as to the importance of this unit, and I'm very happy that it's carrying on the excellent work which has been done over the past decades. I also wanted to, I mean, I can't, since Kalpana talked about my parents, I have to talk about Kalpana's parents. I can't let her. Okay. So, Kalpana's father, KJ, as we used to call him, KJ Kannabiran, was of course the doyen of human rights movement in India. And a lawyer, of course, of excellence. And to all those people who feel they are human rights activists, human rights lawyers, he has been directly or indirectly a mentor to all of us. A mother, of course, a teacher, a feminist of repute, high repute, poet. So, obviously, Kalpana and doesn't suddenly land up here from the sky. I mean, it's her. All these environments make a lot of difference. It is, I believe it has made a difference to me. It has made a difference to Kalpana. And let me just end here by saying that thank you all for organizing this. And hope this continues as years go by. And hope the center continues as the decades go by. Thank you very much.
Questions? We'll have our students pass on the mic.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Kalpana Kannabiran, for that very scintillating lecture and very thought-provoking way you raised the questions about the inviolability of the caste order, that also, you know, just like other women, also affected the Devadasi women, and then how it was implicated in the reform. So I just had a passing question. I mean, nothing that, of course, one will wait to hear your written thing also. Just as you were saying that when the reform came, it was directed against the Isai Vellalar women. However, as Movalu Amrutamammal's book says also, that different Devadasis responded to the reform movement in different ways. So what were the nature of resistances? Like, did all Devadasi women, you know, seek reform, or there were others who also resisted reforms quite? And even as you were speaking about Hemlata Lavanam's, there also, you know, a lot of effort went into seeking reform, which of course was not effected. So a little bit about the women who resisted reform amongst the Isai Vellalar women itself, if there was any.
Actually there is, you look at the responses of the reformed, what we call, for want of a better term, the reformed Devadasis, you will find a parallel resistance, because Bangalore Nagaratnamma, for instance, she was very clear. She said, you can't call us, just because we have relationships with married men, you can't say that we are guilty of adultery, because adultery is only the bane of a married woman. We are not married. The man may be committing adultery. We are not married, so how do you charge us with adultery? So it's only a married woman who can commit adultery. I'm not laying a claim to being married. So where does the question of adultery arise? Now, they had very, very nuanced arguments. There were entire associations of women opposing abolition from the Isai Vellalar groups. There were a number of women who opposed. Some of the women who opposed said that it is the men of their communities. See, because what had started happening was that the men were the instrumentalists, the Nattuvanars. And so the Brahmin performative space, led by Rukmini Devi Arundel, started absorbing the men into the Kalakshetra complex. Yeah? And at lesser levels too. I mean, those were the starts, but at every level you found that men were getting absorbed into a Brahminical space for consideration, for livelihood or whatever. Because the livelihoods were now banned here. One of the arguments was that by women who were resisting abolition was that this is a conspiracy by men who want to, steal our livelihoods from us, because otherwise it is the woman who decides, they want to steal our livelihoods from us. Muthulakshmi Reddy herself has gone on record to say that the women who are resisting abolition are nothing but, to quote her, a set of prostitutes set up by their keepers. You know, so that resistance was significant enough for Muthulakshmi Reddy to react in that manner. And there were associations with 20 women, 30 women. The article Mihir refers to, in fact, I think in the footnotes I've actually given the details of the associations that resisted. But it was too much embedded into daily life, you know, so you couldn't say, okay, this is Devadasi system and pluck those women out of there because, I'll just give you a very small example which I kind of omitted, which is that I visited the friend of my grandmother in Second Rabah, you know, since my grandmother had said, okay, you're talking about Devadasis, I think this mommy will know you, I'll take you to her. So she took me to this regular, very traditional, orthodox Brahmin woman of her generation, my grandmother's generation, from Kumbakonam. And when I said I'm looking at the Devadasi system, so this is the story I got around 86, 87. This woman looked at me very matter of fact and said that in her town in Kumbakonam, the Brahmin homes and the Devadasi homes were on parallel streets, back to back. And she said when a male child was born in a Devadasi home, the child was simply passed over the back wall. And where a female child was born in a Brahmin home, the child was simply passed over the back wall. You know, so if, I mean, for me the thing was that if it was such a routine transaction, then abolition becomes a whole different thing. But you don't at that point, in none of those debates, you have any Dalit intervention into the Devadasi question. That comes only much later. There is a lot of writing on the oppression of caste, on the need to abolish untouchability. You have writing on that. But on the Devadasi question, when in fact temple dedication in Dalit communities also has an old history. I found colonial records, like I said, talking about quote-unquote untouchable Madiga Devadasis. So it's not as if the practice was absent, but the practice is only addressed much later. Abolition demands also come only much later. So what is it about anti-caste mobilization? And at the time when we are talking about the need to abolish Devadasi system among Dalits, you have at this time, just as we speak, even yesterday, you know, I got this flurry of irate mails and petitions. You have now a huge standoff between Bharatanatyam dancers from Brahmin and Savarna backgrounds and dancers from the Isai Velalar background, talking about the question of appropriation, you know, and the Isai Velalar women who are persisting with dance today say that our mothers were not allowed to wear gajalu, they were not allowed to wear the ankle bells, they were not allowed to take a step. Our grandfathers taught Brahmin women who came to learn from these Natuvanar Vadyars. Our grandfathers taught these Brahmin women, but they were all the same age as us, 8-9 years. When any of us said that we want to stand and learn, they asked us to stand right at the end of the room and not be visible. Yeah? Now this has been interpreted differently, that your grandfathers were not abrasive. They were okay about teaching Brahmin girls, so why are you uptight about it? And at which point the Isai Velalar women are now saying they were not uptight in front of you because their livelihoods depended on you, but what do you know that when you left the home, what they would say about having to teach Brahmin women instead of their own women. Do you know any of that discussion that happened? So how do you just assume that dispossession was taken lightly by the men of my grandfather's generation? You know, and this, so it's really odd that at a time when we have the Atrocities Act listing abolition as caste atrocity, you have a resurgence in the Brahmin Isaivelalar debate on who intellectual property belongs to. And in that, when the Isaivelalar Bahujan women have sought support on grounds that they are Bahujan women, the response they have got from some Dalit groups has been that the system has to be abolished. You know, and reform is the only alternative. And so then they're saying, but isn't that a way of pushing it back into Brahmin hands? Then aren't you talking about the annihilation of Brahmin supremacy? And the solution you're suggesting to us is to strengthen Brahmin supremacy. So it's really a very, very complex thing that has acquired even more complex tones now, like in the last 6 months or 8 months or so. In fact, it was because I was intervening in those debates that I said, you know, okay, why don't I just open this up and go back into what I was doing. Yeah.
In Maharashtra, the way Rami is looked at, the fact that Amitri is being basically performed as Maya in closed places by the Brahmin women and the actual Dalit women who were actually the, in the custodians of the, they have lost it. So how do you look at Amitri?
No, I think that, you know, each of these has its, you know, each of these has its specific, each of these has its specificities. There are patterns, of course. Yeah. I was at the Minerva Retreat Festival last week, or early February, where the highlight of the cultural performance was Lavani Kanak. Yeah. So there was a group that performed Lavani in the Lit Fest. And it was like, so you would tell that it is a kind of a very kind of museumized rendition of Lavani for mainstream consumption, you know, dominant class, mainstream consumption. But the exact ways in which that appropriation happens, what is it that
excuse me, mic is not on.
On the face of it, it seems to be a universal thing. But the minute you talk universality, you lose, the specific arguments. Like Mihir was talking about the bar dancers who came to him. Yeah, and so it has to be on a case by case thing. You know, you can draw rough parallels, but even those parallels don't work after a point. Like the deadlock between the Isaivelalar women and Dalit activists opposing the Devadasi system, right? Just jams up the entire debate. So the idea is to keep the debate open and negotiate spaces. You have to negotiate spaces and movements, no? You can't. You can't just have like a one. A uniform solution. Uniformity is the villain of the piece, actually. Yeah.